Chaos Merchants is based on Tupac 187 by R.J. Bond and Michael Douglas Carlin. Role model in the brown bottle, Hennessy. Joel said, "The only thing I don't like about the West Coast is that if they were mad at someone, then they expected their artist to carry that beef. So when Cube decided to leave the group, I remember we came in and was wrapping up some stuff and Dre was like, 'I want you to do this skit.' And I'm like, 'What skit?' He told me he wanted me to say, 'Since Ice Cube is sucking so much New York dick, let him come eat some of this Chicago pussy.' Laughs. I said, 'What?' And Dre said, 'Yeah, he's dick riding. He's riding with New York.' Laughs. That's what I don't like about the West Coast, because that blew my chances of working with Ice Cube." At the Death Row Christmas party in 1995, Mark Anthony Bell is robbed and beaten by Suge Knight, Tupac Shakur, Dr. Dre, and Norris Anderson. Off-duty police officers monitor the scanners and notify the perpetrators that the police have been dispatched and the crime scene is sanitized. When police arrive, they see Bell and ask him if he needs help. Fearing retribution, he waves them off. 2 days later, he files a police report, but because it is stale, the police make no arrests. From the police report, we read photographer Roderick Nixon's account. "He walked into the living room and was looking up at the upstairs balcony when he saw Bell spread out on the balcony. There was a lot of movement. He saw Shakur making a stabbing motion at Bell. He saw another male black assaulting Bell. The suspects then moved Bell away from the balcony and out of his sight. Nixon went down the hill and found police and told them what was happening. Their visit may have saved Bell's life. Knight, Shakur, and Dr. Dre were trying to get Bell to give them the home address of Sean Puffy Combs. Everybody on Death Row Records had taken up Suge Knight's feud with Sean Puffy Combs. Shakur had a beef of his own. For 18 months, Suge pursued Tupac, wanting him to sign with Death Row, only to be brushed off. Tempting as Knight's offers were, Death Row was the premier rap label, putting out one multi-platinum record after another. Tupac had consistently declined to leave Interscope. But in the summer of 1995, when it seemed as though his incarceration might continue indefinitely, for years even, if he was not allowed to post bail, he was more desperate than he'd ever been. It was in this bleak moment that Knight, and apparently Iovine as well, saw the opportunity to arrange things the way they wanted to. It had become not only attractive, but vital to Death Row that Tupac join the label. One of the company's biggest stars, Snoop Doggy Dogg, was facing a murder trial, and it was rumored on the street that Dr. Dre was leaving. Dre would indeed leave by early 1996. Death Row could not afford to lose both artists, and Knight surely knew that Tupac would be more popular than ever after his prison term, more real to his audience than he had been before. What brought Tupac to Death Row? Sitting in Dannemora prison was giving Tupac time to think about his life. He mostly reflected on his current predicament. Agnant's lawyer, Paul Brenner, believes that Tupac should never have been convicted. "It was a very weak case," he says. "A lot went on at Nell's." Brenner suspects that the police planted the gun they found in the hotel room. "I worked for the PBA for 10 years. I know the police. The police are friends of mine," he says. "But Tupac had no friends in the police. I couldn't find a policeman who had a good word to say about Tupac. The problem with attracting that kind of attention was that it attracted the wrong kind of attention from inside the record label." On March 14, 1995, Tupac releases Me Against the World while he was in prison. The album made its debut at number one on the Billboard 200. It is considered one of the most influential hip-hop albums of all time. Interscope achieved double platinum status, but the label gave it a cold reception. It brought out the politicians to put pressure on law enforcement to bring Tupac down. The twice-daily cavity searches by the Dannemora guards were humiliating and degrading. They had him in their control now. Tupac was infamous among law enforcement, and now they held all of the cards. They would make him wish he wasn't there. They would push every prison rule to the nth degree in applying them to Tupac Shakur. Tupac was unsure about the real reason he was in prison. He knew that Haitian Jack set him up, Back then, Tupac ignored the warnings. Jacques had all this gold and diamond jewelry, Man says. He had money. He had a nice BMW. He could get you in any club. Pac was just starting to be known then, and he couldn't get in all the clubs. Jacques spent about $4,000 or $5,000 on Tupac in the beginning. He just overwhelmed him. According to someone else who knew Agnant, Madonna, with whom Tupac would become close, was one of Agnant's celebrity friends. But there had to be more. There had to be others in on it. He thought about all of those that were at the Quad Studios that day. He received anonymous letters telling him that Puffy and Biggie were behind trying to kill him that day. He bought into the lies. Every humiliating act by the guards was just another act of being violated to take out on those that set him up. He retraced his steps. Tupac had a lot of pending cases which really took a lot of money. I mean, he probably had cases in almost every state. Strapped for cash, Tupac put feelers out for work. Little Sean was an artist managed by Haitian Jack. He told Tupac if he came down to the Quad Studios, he would pay him to lay down some tracks. As Tupac's entourage got into the elevator, men with guns appeared and told them to get down on their knees. Tupac was uncooperative. He grabbed the gun and was shot in the stomach. As Tupac reached for one of his guns that he carried in his front pockets of his pants, the gun went off and Tupac shot himself. That bullet ricocheted around the elevator with fragments that also hit Tupac. Tupac's jewelry was stolen, and he made his way up to the studios where he hid the gun inside the piano. Biggie didn't even know Pac was going to be there. These guys pull guns on them and get them in the elevator. Pac grabbed for the gun, and that's how he got shot. The guns were called the Twins, which he carried loaded and cocked most of the time. He always carried a gun in his pants, and it was cocked half the time. There were people that were close to him that knew that the groin area gunshot came from his own gun, and none of us said anything, and it took on a life of its own. Biggie had nothing to do with Pac getting shot, and when Biggie came to visit Pac in the hospital, he told him about stashing the gun at the studio. Biggie offered to go get the gun. So Biggie and Man go to the studio, and Biggie distracts everybody there while Man opens the piano and retrieves the gun. Haitian Jack had something to do with Tupac being shot. Pac came to the studio to lay down a track for an artist that Jack manages. So it came from Jack. Biggie had nothing to do with it. Haitian Jack was a nefarious criminal connected to all of the wrong people in New York. He took Tupac under his wing. He was in a hotel room when the sexual assault Tupac was accused of occurred. Tupac, Haitian Jack, and Charles Man Fuller were all charged with the crime, but Haitian Jack somehow managed to get charges against him dropped. That fact alone screams setup. The Quad Studios shooting was probably also a setup. Keep in mind that Tupac had attracted the attention of Vice President Dan Quayle as he denounced gangster rap in a speech seeking censorship of the music industry. Tupac had shot Atlanta off-duty cops, and those charges were dropped. Police all over America had their sights set on putting Tupac behind bars, and he had even attracted unwanted attention of the FBI. But if prison was the downside, album sales were the upside. Suge had been courting Tupac. Suge's big fear was that Tupac would sign with Sean Combs. That would have been a devastating blow to Suge. Suge Knight was beginning to understand the difference between marketing and publicity. You could spend millions of dollars marketing and not move a single record. You could spend nothing and get publicity with an incident and get a platinum album. Tupac was a prime example. Every time he was in the news, his album sales grew. When he shot the two off-duty police in Atlanta and got away with it, he became a legend. When he was indicted for rape in what appeared to be a total setup by law enforcement, his popularity grew. But when he was shot 4 times in New York, he became a superstar. There is no evidence that Death Row Records was behind the anonymous letters, but it fits the pattern of anonymous tips coming into law enforcement to sway the investigations in the El Rey Theater murder of Kelly Jamerson, the Tupac Shakur murder, and the murder of Biggie Smalls. Whether the letters came from Death Row or another source, they successfully swayed Tupac by sowing the seeds of distrust. When Suge stood on stage and called Puffy out, many saw this as Suge reaching out to Tupac. he would never sign with Bad Boy Records now that he believed that word on the streets was that Biggie was behind the Quad Studios shooting. Signing Tupac was just a shot across the bow. Puffy would have loved to have Tupac on Bad Boy. Suge learned from David Kenner's tactics to divide and conquer to keep Tupac away from Puffy's camp. Now Tupac had taken up Suge's hatred of the East Coast. For Suge, it was personal. Once Tupac came out of prison and joined Death Row, he probably did more to stoke the flames of a much publicized feud between East and West Coast rappers than anyone. Suge got Dre, Tupac, and Suge's homies to participate in the beating of Mark Anthony Bell at the Death Row Christmas party in 1995 to attempt to get Puffy's home address. Since they didn't get the address, at least Puffy would hear about it and hold it against Tupac, closing that door to him in the future. But that still didn't make Suge and Puffy even. On or after October 11th, 1995, Tupac was released from prison on bail pending his appeal. During the short period of less than 1 year between Tupac's release from prison and his death, Tupac recorded 3 full CDs and approximately 152 other tracks. Many of those tracks had not been released at the time of his death in September 1996. Subsequent to October 11, 1995, Interscope and Death Row produced and released a double album recorded by Tupac entitled All Eyes on Me, Eyes, which, having sold more than 5 million copies, went quintuple platinum. According to Death Row, Eyes was the first double CD album in rap music history and was only made possible by Tupac's incredible energy and productivity. Based on the 1995 Dannemora Agreement and the sales of Eyes, Tupac was entitled to receive gross royalties of $12 million. Additionally, by reason of the sales of Eyes, Tupac was entitled to receive a $5 million advance on his next album. Thus, during the period of time from his release from prison until his death, Death Row owed Tupac $17 million. Yet, when he died, Tupac was virtually penniless. He owned almost nothing. He owned no real estate. He owned no stocks or bonds. He owned 2 cars, one of which was compensation for his appearance in a commercial. During the period of his career with Death Row, Tupac never received an actual accounting from Death Row of the monies due to him. Instead, Tupac was repeatedly told by Knight, Kenner, and other Death Row employees that he actually owed money to Death Row. Tupac would soon understand that none of the artists on Death Row Records were getting their money. Jewel told him, "Make sure you tell Suge I want my money and writing credit on this song. I can't work for free anymore." "Aw, girl, your brother gonna make sure you get all of your credit. You don't have to worry about that," Tupac snapped back before I could finish my statement with a cloud of smoke coming out of his mouth. "I'm not trying to be difficult, but I need to get paid. It's tight out here for me. This guy doesn't want to pay me anything, and I'm tired of hearing my work on the radio but not making any money." Tupac looked at me like I was crazy. Snoop and Corrupt kept smoking, acting like they didn't hear what I said. I decided to just leave it alone and discuss it with Suge when I saw him. I tried not to involve anyone else in my mess. It was apparent to me that these guys didn't want to talk about Suge, so I just shut my mouth. Pac was getting ripped off. Daz was getting ripped off. I was getting paid at first about $10,000 a month. Then it went down to basically $4,000 to $5,000 a month. But what was happening? Reggie was quote unquote sending Tupac. Tupac was getting bills for $30,000, $40,000 a month in security. And basically, you know, are you paying me that kind of money? He says, "What kind of money am I making? I ain't making that kind of money." That is what they were billing. Of course, that was Suge's whole... That was my way for Suge to go ahead and extort money back. Tupac had declared his unhappiness with his career path and was planning to make major changes. Tupac had personally mentioned to me that he only had one album left to turn into Death Row, and that album was recorded already. He told me he was planning to move on and launch his own label with his crew, The Outlaws. Of course, that never happened. When he got shot, it seemed like everything was shut down in Death Row. They were sitting on top of the world in one instance, and in the blink of an eye, it was all gone, just like that. And so was Pac. Just a few days earlier, on August 27th, Tupac had severed a critical tie to Death Row. He had been on the set all day, and in the studio all night, Fuller recalls. He sent us to the studio to get cassettes of what he'd done the night before. He wanted to listen to it. They said no, that Kenner wouldn't allow it. Pac went crazy. He fired Kenner. I typed the letter, and he gave me permission to hire another lawyer. Tupac made it clear in New York, 4 days before his murder, that he was leaving Death Row Records. In New York, an argument took place between Tupac and Suge. I'm going to cut out Machiavelli, and when I cut out Machiavelli, I'm the hell up out of here. You got your money. I don't want nothing else to do with Death Row. I'm out. Tupac said, fuck it, I'm out of here. I think Tupac wanted to leave, and Death Row didn't want him to go. We knew that Pac wasn't coming. Pac didn't want to go to Vegas. Tupac specifically said, I'm a dead man walking. Juice and Tangeray made his getaway. Snoop Dogg was one of Suge Knight's discoveries. Death Row Records was the house that Snoop built. Legal troubles had worked so well in getting Snoop to sign a management contract. He literally signs one day after being arrested for murder. Suge Knight used to slap Snoop Dogg around like he was a little girl. Suge wasn't happy at all when he learned about our situation. He tried to punk Snoop every chance he could. I hated that Snoop was scared to stand up to Suge. But Suge held Snoop's freedom in his hands. Snoop was being represented by David Kenner in his murder trial, and he was reluctant to rock the boat while he was facing the realistic possibility of life in prison. All Snoop could do was bite his tongue and wait for his opportunity. Snoop, Daz, Corrupt, and Dre all feared his wrath. Suge had turned into a tyrant, and he had them shook. Dre began acting distant, moody, and standoffish each time I saw him. When I asked him what was wrong, he always brushed it off and didn't say much. I could tell he was not happy with the way things were being done. Nobody was happy anymore, but nobody was doing anything about it either. Or were they? A week after Tupac got out of prison, Snoop and Pac were supposed to perform at the Roseanne Barr show. Snoop never showed up. Pac was irate, and he was talking about Snoop. He didn't come to the rehearsal. Pac and Ice-T host the show and performed without Snoop. The rivalry between Tupac and Snoop was growing. Pac was like Suge's little brother. Snoop had been on Death Row Records far longer than Tupac, but Tupac didn't respect it. Suge would remind Tupac that this is the house Snoop built, be respectful. But Suge would pile on the disrespected Snoop. One time, Tupac and Suge made Snoop ride on top of the luggage in the SUV. Add to that humiliation the fact that interviewers were always more interested in Tupac. Matulu was convinced that Tupac became a lightning rod after he shot the policeman in Atlanta. These disenfranchised, the young blacks who are poor and hopeless, have no leader, Matulu said. Their heroes are cultural and sports heroes. No one, not Jesse Jackson, not Ben Chavez, not Louis Farrakhan, has as much influence with this segment as rappers. On March 7, 1996, a fight occurred between Death Row Records personnel and Bad Boy Records personnel. Police officers responding to Death Row Records noted that recording artist Snoop Doggy Dogg was present at the location with additional gang members. Moreover, at least one off-duty LAPD officer, directly employed by Snoop Doggy Dogg as a bodyguard, was at the site. On March 14, Snoop Dogg and his bodyguard McKinley Lee are found not guilty of murder charges stemming from his arrest in 1993. Dr. Dre enters into an agreement with Death Row Records, relinquishing his 50% ownership in the label, effectively leaving Death Row Records. Snoop had looked at Dre as a mentor, so when he wasn't there, it was hard for him to be completely happy. Snoop knew that if it weren't for Dre giving him the opportunity, he wouldn't have been the star he is now. July 1st, 1996, from police logs. Received telephone call from Detective Caffey, number 23900, Career Criminal Apprehension Unit. He advised me that Death Row Records is owned by Suge Knight, a Compton Blood, Mob Piru gang member. Dr. Dre used to be a 50% controlling partner of Death Row Records with Suge. Knight had a falling out with Snoop Doggy Dogg. Dr. Dre has signed with another music company by the name of Interscope MCA. Snoop Doggy Dogg is an Insane Crips gang member from Long Beach, not a Rollin' 20s as previously documented. Detective Caffey further advised that Agent Alexander from ATF is currently conducting a federal investigation for firearms violations along with the IRS for an income tax evasion case on death row records. He also stated that Tupac Shakur is a Compton Blood gang member and that Warren G. also frequents death row records. Warren G. is a gang member from Compton and his father is a Black Panther member from Oakland. When Tupac and Snoop were performing at the House of Blues, the crowd was mildly enthusiastic for Snoop, but when Tupac appeared, the crowd went wild. That event alone put a chasm between the rappers, and when a rift occurs between two leaders, the minions magnify it. Their respective entourages were soon openly at war. Death Row had begun recouping against Snoop's $5 million legal bill, that the victory had been financed entirely on Suge's dime, worked to legally justify the label's position in ceasing to pay Snoop while it collected against the debt, did not calm the label's only remaining marquee superstar. As a result, the sentiment between the two parties grew all the more sour as months passed. Radio came on with Snoop Dogg saying, "I don't have no beef with New York," which sent Pac into a rage. After Tupac perceived that Snoop had betrayed him by siding with Puffy and the notorious B.I.G. with whom Tupac was beefing, Snoop's interactions with Pac completely changed. When I got back to the hotel, it was a whole nother atmosphere, like he sent his homeboy to get the bud for me as opposed to him coming to get it for me. So I felt funny. When I got on the plane to go to L.A. the next day, Suge didn't let none of my security ride with me. I had to ride on the plane with him, his homies, and Pac. And it was the most uncomfortable ride I had in my life. Because my man didn't say nothing to me the whole ride. That's a 5-hour flight on a private plane. At one point, Snoop actually feared for his life on the flight. I walk up to him, maybe 3 hours into the flight, sit next to him like, "You going to Vegas, cuz?" He turns away from me, starts talking to someone else. I'm like, "All right, go in the back, put the blanket on my head, knife in my hand, fork in my hand, and just sleep the rest of the ride, because I feel like they finna try to do something." We land, and I got my Rolls Royce picking me up, and he got his picking him up, and I say, "Yo, Pac, you going to Vegas?" And he just gives me this real stank-ass look and don't say nothing. "That's it," Dad says. There was turmoil inside the family that you wouldn't know. Shit goes haywire. They was trying to get us to go to Vegas at the time Tupac was killed. Dog pound, we was really on our fuck Death Row shit. We was already saying fuck Death Row. 3 days later, Tupac was shot in Las Vegas. He died from wounds he sustained that night. If Snoop's cousin was the shooter in Las Vegas, it is inconceivable that Snoop didn't know about it either before or after the fact. Dad says he wanted to go to Vegas. I could have jumped out on his, Suge's ass, in Vegas, but you know, it was killing me, but Snoop said, "Hold on, don't fuck this up." I respected that. I got him another day. Remember that interview with allhiphop.com where Snoop says that Lil Half Dead will not let anybody talk bad about Snoop? This basically paints Lil Half Dead as Snoop's enforcer. This might explain why Snoop began the narrative that Suge Knight was behind the murder of Tupac. Is it to throw investigators off the trail? One incident happened at the Universal Amphitheater on May 14, 1998. Snoop said that his security detail ditched him, and sheriffs say that he was approached by gang members affiliated with Death Row Records, Bloods, that meant to do him harm. They saved him from that harm, and he told them that Suge was responsible for Tupac's murder. According to Kevin Hackey, Snoop was spreading the rumor that Suge ordered Tupac's hit. Snoop basically said he is for sure dogged, meaning Suge had him killed to basically throw the attention off him. Many investigators have cited Suge Knight for being uncooperative, but in the interview for the Biggie and Tupac documentary, Suge is candid about Snoop without mentioning him by name. The Death Row Records website broadcasts a message to Snoop. 2001, the year of fear. All dogs run and hide. Suge is coming home. Snoop said, "We start a coalition, and we get rid of Suge Knight, number one," snaps his fingers, "for good, because that's a bump in the road. And when you got a negative bump in the road, it makes it hard." In 1998, Snoop told police that he felt he was in grave danger as a result of leaving Death Row Records. The other thing Snoop likes about being with No Limit is being able to see his money. Nothing is hidden from him. Snoop claims, as was the case when Sharitha Knight, Suge's wife, was his manager, and when David Kenner, Death Row and Knight's lawyer, negotiated terms for both sides. According to Snoop, he couldn't get any royalties until the legal fees from his murder trial. He was acquitted of first and second degree murder in Los Angeles, February 21st, 1996, were paid for. Daz releases The Road Killer, with an appearance by Snoop and the Dog Pound, depicting Suge Knight being kidnapped and humiliated. The Row was the new name for Death Row Records after Suge got out of prison. Snoop, Dre, Daz, and others all remember the days when they felt they were not being properly paid by Suge Knight. They take joy in toying with him today by telling him that they owe him money that they never give him. The way they lured him down to the set of Straight Outta Compton was by telling him they were going to square him away with money. When he showed up, there were thugs waiting to give him a beating or potentially kill him. Supposedly, there is a video of the thugs with guns. That video has, so far, been excluded from the trial. Clearly, there are those that fear Suge Knight and want him dead, or he wouldn't have been shot on August 24th, 2014, 6 days after the leak of the confession letter by LAPD. In 1998, Snoop officially left Death Row, and it was a very messy split. In an interview with the Long Beach Press-Telegram at the time, Snoop said, "I definitely feel my life is in danger if I stay in Death Row Records. That's part of the reason why I'm leaving." Snoop also told the Press-Telegram that he was planning to leave the label because there's nothing over there. Suge Knight is in jail, the president, Dr. Dre left, and Tupac Shakur is dead. It's telling me that I'm either going to be dead or in jail, or I'm going to be nothing. These are the footnotes. Time served my days and nights on Death Row Records, Simone Green. Wallace civil trial, July 23rd, 2002. Order granting and denying motions in Wallace Estate v. City of Los Angeles. Frank Alexander's secret tape recordings of a conversation with Michael Moore speculate about who would replace Suge. Dub CNN interview with Jewel by Chad Kaiser, November 2011. The takedown of Tupac by Connie Brook, The New Yorker, 7 July 1997. Wetani Teyahimba, Tupac's manager. Charles Man-Man Fuller from Tupac, The Early Years by Aton Gregory and Lena Sunday. Karen Lee, Tupac's publicist and family friend, from Tupac, The Early Years by Aton Gregory and Lena Sunday. These are repeats. Adversary Complaint, Afeni Shakur and Amaru Entertainment vs. Death Row Records, February 12, 2008. My Blood, My Sweat, My Tears, The Autobiography of Jewel Caples by Felicia St. John. Russell Poole tape-recorded interview with Death Row Dave on February 6, 2014. Kevin Hackey interview with LAPD detectives Miller and Poole, 5/12/1998. Frank Alexander's secret tapes. Michael Moore interview from Tupac Conspiracy directed by R.J. Bond. Russell Poole tape-recorded interview with Death Row Dave on February 6, 2014. Attributed to Kenneth Archer in Tupac Conspiracy, directed by R.J. Bond. Calvin Brodus versus Sharitha Knight case number TAC 50-97. Statement of L.A. Arnwine, a Long Beach police officer working undercover for the FBI and ATF investigating Death Row Records on 9/29/97. Frank Alexander speaks on Tupac and Snoop Dogg beef in 1996. There's a YouTube link. Producer Daryl Harper about tension between Tupac's entourage and Snoop Dogg's entourage. And it's a web link. Suge Knight, The Rise and Fall and Ruse of Death Row Records by Jake Brown. Snoop Lion remembers final interaction with Tupac, talks gun buyback program by Roman Cooper. The smoking section, the day Snoop and Tupac stopped seeing eye to eye. Classic Snoop Dogg interview, disses Ja Rule, talks about East Coast biting the West. Tupac Escobar 300 blog. VladTV.com. Daz Dillinger's says Michelle A. fucks up Death Row. And it's a YouTube link. VladTV.com. Daz Dillinger says Suge has a restraining order against me for life. YouTube link. Snoop and Lil Half Dead interview with AllHipHop.com. Calvin Brodus interview with sheriffs on May 14, 1998. Brad Welker, Lieutenant. Kevin Hackey interview with LAP detectives Miller and Poole, 5/12/1998. Biggie and Tupac by Nick Broomfield, 2002. allhiphop.com, Snoop Dogg, The Realist, Part 1. Washington Post, gangster rap brought Suge Knight wealth and lots of trouble. Now he's singing a different tune. June 17, 2007, by Teresa Wiltz. Vibe Magazine, September 1998, The Treacherous 2, by Chio Hodari Coker. And these are two website links. I'll try to put all the YouTube videos and links from these in the description below. This concludes Chaos Merchants Episode 4. We'll see you in Episode 5.